Guys, it's your favorite reliability test guy here with another fun-filled, action-packed video on reliability tests and validation topics. This current video is on acceleration testing, the change you can feel. I hope you enjoyed this video, and if you do, don't forget to hit that like button and subscribe to my channel. Thanks for watching, and let's get started! In this video, we will cover definitions, theory, and application for acceleration testing. So what is acceleration? Acceleration is the change you can feel. When you change position, also known as displacement, you can see the change, but change in velocity or speed is something you can feel in your chest, especially if it is a significant amount of change in velocity. Acceleration is a vector quantity, which means that it has a magnitude and direction component. In vibration testing, however, this is not the case, as we usually talk in terms of gravitational units, which is expressed only in the magnitude component. Therefore, in the case of gravitational acceleration, it is expressed as a scalar quantity. So why do you feel acceleration? Why do you get that feeling that you get as you take off in an aircraft or step on the throttle in your car? Because of the change in your state of your body's current equilibrium, of course. There are many things that you can feel when external conditions change, such as when you put your hand in the refrigerator to grab a beer while enjoying my awesome videos. The change in temperature from the air inside of the refrigerator can be felt. Likewise to the temperature example, when you are sitting at a red light in your car and then you accelerate when the light turns green, you can feel the change as your body goes from a rest state to a state of acceleration to get the car moving. Or when you're driving at a constant speed and then you stop on the throttle, you can feel the change in speed, aka acceleration. Why do you feel changes when a mechanical force makes you move? It's called inertia. Inertia is the tendency of a mass to resist a change in motion from its equilibrium state. When a force causes you or an object to move, initially your body mass or the object's mass is perfectly happy in its current equilibrium state and does not want to change to another state, whether it's a change from a rest state or a constant motion state. Have you ever crashed head-on into an object on a bicycle and flew over the handlebars? Lucky you if it hasn't happened at some point in your life, but what is happening is your body is perfectly happy at the current motion state in which you are cruising along on your bicycle. When you crash into an object, your bike immediately stops, but your body keeps on moving, and you continue to move until good old gravity puts you back on the ground. Good times, good times. Let's go ahead and define acceleration testing. Acceleration testing tests for things such as continuation of operation of a system under high acceleration, such as electronics on a fighter jet, assessment of structural integrity of a part under high acceleration, strength of a part under high acceleration, and testing for crash safety acceleration to ensure that a part does not fly off a vehicle in a crash event and kill the pilot or a bystander. A very common standard that is used for acceleration testing is MIL Standard 810, which is currently at Revision H, under Section 513.8. The tests covered in Section 513.8 are structural testing, operational testing, crash hazard acceleration testing, and strength testing. Acceleration testing is useful for driving out design weaknesses and defects, such as yielding or deformation of structural parts of your system, leaking seals, broken mounts that hold the system in place, pumps that cavitate and get trapped there as a result of the high acceleration, misreadings on mechanical and electronic instrumentation, intermittent contactor and relay connections, and relays and contactors opening and closing at undesired times, and moving mechanical and electromechanical parts that get stuck or bind as a result of the high acceleration. So what kind of acceleration levels are we talking about here when referring to acceleration testing? Well, that depends on the vehicle and the failure mode you are testing for. It could be anything from 2 Gs, as with an aircraft in forward acceleration, and up to 40 Gs for certain crash safety scenarios. To put things in perspective, a Mercedes-AMG A45S has a max acceleration of 0.71 Gs for a wide open throttle launch. That's some serious acceleration levels we are talking about testing here. So how on earth can we perform acceleration testing without mounting parts on a fighter jet and performing crazy maneuvers to achieve test G levels? With a centrifuge, of course. A centrifuge has many different applications in fields such as chemistry, aerospace, military, and space flight training, and even household uses. Yes, you most likely use a centrifuge once or twice a week when you wash your clothes in a washing machine. A washing machine is a centrifuge. Pretty cool, huh? A centrifuge that is commonly used for aerospace applications is a rotating machine that has a rotor that spins, with a boom or arm that extends from the rotor on two opposite ends. One end has either a capsule that is for humans to sit in to train for high G-level experience on a fighter jet, or it is for mounting parts that are tested under high acceleration conditions. The other end has a counterweight to balance the weight of a human or part on the other end of the centrifuge. Since a centrifuge spins at high RPM, the loads need to be balanced on both arms or the centrifuge will start to wobble and can damage or destroy itself. You have probably noticed this when you didn't balance the load of your washing machine, such as with a large rug that folds over itself on one side of the washing machine, causing your washer to wobble violently back and forth. You have been on a centrifuge before if you've ever visited Epcot in Orlando, Florida, which has a ride called Mission Space, which subjects you to a 2.5 G max acceleration. For the average unconditioned and untrained individual, this ride can feel very intense, and you will most likely feel dizzy and lightheaded after getting off the ride. There are even barf bags on the ride in the event you get sick. If you have experienced this and think that that is intense, the max acceleration of a manned rocket launch has a maximum acceleration 0.5 Gs higher at 3 Gs. If you haven't been on a centrifuge before, it is hard to imagine what it feels like by looking at an inanimate object spinning around on a centrifuge if you were to perform an acceleration test. To best visualize how significant acceleration G levels can be, there's not a better example than to watch a human pilot be exposed to high G levels. Pictured is a pilot training for a max acceleration level of 9 Gs. Notice how intense it is, but he doesn't pass out. This is not a novel thing to be able to accomplish. Along with intense physical training and physical health, you also have to have years of training and also have perfect genetics for this type of application in order to be able to survive and stay awake and alert in this type of high G environment. As your body is accelerated to high G levels, blood gets trapped in your legs and is unable to be pumped to your heart and your brain, which will cause you to pass out depending on the G level. The average person will pass out from an acceleration of 4 to 5 Gs, while the pilot was able to take 9 Gs like a champ, even though it looked like it was extremely painful based on the feedback of his face. There are techniques as well to keep blood at the heart, such as squeezing your legs and your buttocks to keep pressure up and keep blood flowing through your heart and to your brain. There is technology as well called anti-G suits that detects high G levels and compresses certain parts of your body to keep blood pressure up and pumping through your heart. Let's go ahead and take a look at the physics of how a centrifuge simulates acceleration levels at very high levels. You might have heard the term before of centrifugal force, which is a classical physics definition of a force that is pulling a mass away from a rotating center if you are in the same frame of reference of the mass. There is a lot of confusion with centrifugal force. It's not really a force per se, as there isn't an external centrifugal force acting on a rotating body. However, what is at play here is inertia. Say you have a small object tied to a string and begin to spin the object over your head. Now let's say the string breaks or you lose grip of the string and the object will fly off away from the rotating center, which is your arm, and continues in the direction it was currently moving. This is simply the principle of inertia, of an object maintaining its current vector of motion at the equilibrium state that the object is currently moving in. If you have a washing machine with a viewing window, you will notice that your clothes, bed sheets, loose change, and car keys you left in your pants pocket spin around, stuck against the wall of the drum of the washing machine. When a rotating body spins fast enough, such as a spinning wheel, an object within that wheel has a force imposed on it that causes the object to move and gain momentum. As the rotating wheel continues to rotate, the object's inertia causes it to continue to move in its current direction, which causes the object to remain pressed against the wheel as it rotates and spins around and around against the wall of the wheel. This is due to both the force of the wheel pushing the object into motion and also pushing against the object to prevent it from moving away from the spinning wheel, or keeps the object contained within the spinning wheel. Now, when we are talking about a centrifuge, what we described with the arms that protrude out from the rotating center or the object swung over your head attached to the string is another force in play here. It is called the centripetal force. The centripetal force is a force acting on a rotating object that keeps it from moving away from the center as a result of the object's inertia. In the instance of the string is applying a force to the spinning object that causes it to keep rotating around your arm. With a centrifuge, as a result of the rotation, an object or person inside of the capsule attached to the arm of the centrifuge. With a centrifuge, as a result of the rotation, an object or person inside of a capsule attached to the arm of the centrifuge will feel an outward acceleration perpendicular to the rotating body of the centrifuge, and you are forced to rotate in a circle, but your body or object's mass's inertia continues to move in the same direction it was continuing in. This concept is how high G levels are possible in circular motion, making it possible to simulate space vehicle launches and high G maneuvers of a fighter jet aircraft. Let's go ahead and apply what we just learned to an example. I'm excited, and I know that you are excited because this is the best part of my videos. Pictured is a diagram for an acceleration test centrifuge system. The system consists of a rotor, a test box or capsule, and on the opposite end, a counterweight. Here is a side view diagram of a test box. The test box acts as a chamber to contain the DUT or device under test. It has a mounting plate that will allow you to mount a test fixture of all different shapes and sizes within the limitations of the inner dimensions of the test box. The test box is typically made out of a thick steel material that will contain the part in the event that the part breaks off or disassembles and prevents it from flying away from the centrifuge. In this example, we want to test a widget that is mounted on an aircraft using the General Aircraft Verification Test Procedure in MIL Standard 810H513.8 as pictured. You will need to configure the controller for your centrifuge to run each of the accelerations, but you also need to keep in mind the orientation of your device under test. You will need to consider the normal mounting orientation when mounting the DUT inside of the test box for a given acceleration test. For instance, you will need to think about the direction of the device under test when testing for accelerations in the fore, aft, up, down, and lateral directions. Another very important thing to consider is the balancing of the centrifuge. You need to consider the counterweight on the opposite end of the centrifuge and make sure that it is enough to balance out the weight of the test fixture, DUT, and any other mass you have added inside of your test box. If you screw this up, it's going to be a bad time for you. Just think of an unbalanced washing machine, except in a more catastrophic and dangerous level of magnitude. This is why you will typically see a centrifuge inside of a bunker or even below ground surrounded by concrete. If a part does fly out of the test box or the centrifuge somehow disassembles, it can cause significant damage to the surrounding area and even kill someone if it is not in a protected area. And that's it, folks. Some key takeaways from this video are, when you feel acceleration, you are experiencing your body's own resistance to the change in speed known as inertia. The centrifugal force is not a real force. It is simply a way to visualize the effects of inertia when an object maintains its current equilibrium state and vector direction while a force is applied to that object that causes it to move in a circular direction. Acceleration, especially at high accelerations, can be intense for many people and objects, as we saw in the previous examples. You will need to design and test your part to ensure that rapid changes in speed and direction do not cause your part to break off from its mount or produce an undesired event, such as opening or closing a relay or contactor, which, depending on what it controls, can kill the pilot and any other passengers. Centripetal forces keep the object or a human from moving away from the rotating body as a result of inertia. A piece of string tied to an object that is spun above your head applies a centripetal force, or the arm of a centrifuge keeps the test box and device under test from flying away from the centrifuge. And most important, be safe. Don't be stupid and turn on a centrifuge while someone or yourself is inside of the centrifuge area. Don't wait until your boss leaves for the day and use the centrifuge for joyrides. Follow your company's safety protocols and processes, as a centrifuge is one of the most dangerous pieces of test equipment that you will ever encounter. The force and power of a centrifuge is quite impressive to see in person, and it needs to be respected. Thank you for watching this video. If you have any questions or comments or need help with acceleration testing, feel free to reach out to me at the link above or at one of the links in the description below. I hope you enjoyed this video, and if you did, don't forget to hit that like button and subscribe to my channel. Thanks again for watching, and enjoy the rest of your day, and be safe in these crazy times.